مساء الخير جميعا، برحب بيكم كلكم في الفيرست ويبينار اوف ذا ايجيبشن فيرتيليتي ميتنج. النهارده وي هاف فيري نايس ليكتشرز باي فيري امينينت سبيكرز. عشان ما نضيعش وقت، اول محاضره is going to be about fibroids and infertility. Professor Jamal Absoor needs no introduction by any means. The president of the society, past president of FIGO, co-founder of the society, founder of the Islamic population study, publications la hasra laha. الحقيقة it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Jamal Absoor to speak about fibroids and infertility. Professor Jamal, please go ahead.
Hello.
أيوه.
Hello.
سامعينك يا دكتور جمال، please
share screen.
Go on, share screen.
Hello.
أيوة، we have Hello. You, Professor Jamal.
Hello.
أيوة.
Hello. Hello.
Professor Jamal, we can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Can you speak?
Okay. Can you? Yes, please. Share screen. Professor Jamal, everything's fine. Your shared screen was there. Yes, please.
Welcome to this webinar. The first talk is about fibroids and infertility. The learning objectives of the presentations are the prevalence of fibroid in reproductive age, what is the impact of myoma on fertility, the management of fibroid, and then the take-home message. Infertility, as defined by ICMART and WHO, is a disease of the reproductive system defined by the failure to achieve a clinical pregnancy after 12 months or more of regular unprotected sexual intercourse. In a recent analysis of 2,500 cases of infertility, it had been shown that uterine factor is responsible for around 10% of the cases, and most of these are due to uterine myoma. We do know that there is a high prevalence of uterine myoma, varying between 80 to 60% among women. However, it is only 30% of these patients that they have symptoms which deserve treatment and for which they seek treatment. Fibroids shows also a high degree of heterogeneity, growth even in the same patient. And though the prevalence of fibroid is between 60 to 80% among women, yet among the infertile women, it is responsible for partially for infertility in around 8%. But as the sole cause of infertility, it is only present in 2 to 3% because most of the time it is associated with other factors. And we are liable to see more and more cases of fibroids because of the increasing age of marriage, which is happening over the past 30 years in all continents, whether Africa, Asia, or Europe, to the mid-20s and early 30s. Furthermore, there is, according to the United Nations statistics, there is an increasing age of women at the birth of the first child, reaching to the age of 30 and above in some countries, and to the late 20s in other countries. And also increase of the other risk factors like obesity, and it had been shown over the past 30 years, there had been increasing risk of obesity, particularly in the developing countries. Also smoking is increasing, particularly in developing countries. And this recent trend of women to delay childbirth to their 30s and 40s, coupled with the recent change in lifestyle, women around the globe resulted in an increasing number of infertile patients seeking treatment and have meiosis, and most of the time, more than one myoma. And in ART unit, it had been shown that fibroids are present in almost 27% of patients coming for assisted reproductive technology. Now, does fibroids have an impact on infertility or not? This is a very important question because this is relevant to treatment. We understand that the pathogenesis of fibroid, they come from the clonal expansion of a single myometrial smooth muscle cell transformation by cellular injury, and there is low rate of cell proliferation combined with production of copious amounts of extracellular matrix, which accounts for the tumor expansion. And a common saline feature of fibroid is the responsiveness to steroid hormone. Steroid hormones play a very important role in the pathogenesis of fibroids, whether estrogen or progesterone. And furthermore, this would result also in change in the histopathology of the fibroid with hematoxylin and leucine. You can see in the fibroids on the right-hand side, the increased nuclear thickness, the increased nuclear thickness, and in the immune assay, you can see the increased oxygen, the estrogen receptor, and progesterone receptors. Thus, steroid hormones, whether they are coming from the ovary or the adrenal, through the circulation, they reach to the myometrial cells. And inside the myometrial cell also, there is change of the androgen by the aromatase, and this results in the increased expression of estrogen receptors and progesterone receptors. We all know that fibroids are different, and according to VU classification, there are different types of pathology of fibroids, and consequently, they are likely to affect the fertility by various mechanisms. We do understand that sub-serous fibroids are not likely to affect the fertility. However, those who are present inside the wall of uterus, whether they cause infertility or not, this is a matter of debate. Those inside the cavity of uterus, we do know that they do result in reduction of implantation and increased rate of abortion. With intramural fibroid, which are not projecting inside the uterine cavity, it had been shown that they do cause the reduction of fertility through various factors, either change in the implantation factor because of the reduction of hoxetin factor and also the glycosidine factor. They also result in the immunological and endocrinological change from the SUDI capsule with the production of the aromatase expression with the junction zone with increased expression of estrogen and progesterone receptors and also with the decrease in the implantation form, but also because there is an increased peristalsis resulting in contraction because of an increased production of oxytocin and the neurotoxins, which would result in increased contraction. Thus, fibroids would result in reduction of fertility by various mechanisms, either physical because of the location, which would impede the egg or sperm transport and the proximity of the endometrium, pathology of the fibroid, impaired uterine peristalsis, vascular change, chronic inflammatory response by the endometrium, or disruption of the uterine intracavitary biochemical milieu, and the impaired endometrial receptivity, and also with altered implantation factors. Furthermore, clinical studies, particularly from ART, had shown us that subserous myoma, as I mentioned before, they are unlikely to affect fertility. And when it comes to intramural myoma, though, we said that they are associated with change in the chronological and also biological and increased contraction, yet whether if intramural fibroid, which does not distort the uterine cavity, does it affect fertility or not, had been a matter of a debate. And when we look at the very early studies which were published early, one of them was when our own study published more than 20 years ago on 39 patients, and we had shown that in this patient, the fibroid less than 7 centimeters, they are unlikely to affect fertility. And then another study later on appeared more recently on 240 patients, 120 patients each arm, had shown that the presence of asymptomatic small fibroid less than 5 centimeters does not affect the ART outcome. However, other studies had shown different results. And this meta-analysis of 19 observational studies performed on 6,000 cycles of IVF had shown that intramural fibroid not distorting the uterine cavity result in reduction of the live birth rate by 21%. And if we look at the prospective studies in that meta-analysis, we find that there is a reduction of the live birth rate as high as 40% after three attempts in a 12-month period. And another study which appeared from Japan on a large study on 250 patients each arm had shown that there is a significant negative effect on live birth rate when the largest tumor was more than 3 centimeters. And actually, because this study was a very good one, based on this study, another study from Hammersmith and the Queen Charlotte Hospital over a period of 5 years on a large number of patients from one center and studied the impact of intramural fibroid not distorting the uterine cavity, whether it is a single myoma or multiple myoma, whether it is more than 3 centimeters or less than 3 centimeters. And this study included 163 patients with intramural myoma compared with 390 patients as a control. And there were 40% of the patients had single myoma, 60% of the patients had multiple myoma, and the size of the myoma varied between 1 and 8 centimeters. And when they looked into the live birth rate for patients with a single myoma, as you can see for the one fibroid, the difference in was, there is no difference, statistically significant, there is no difference between the live birth rate when the patient has single myoma less than 3 centimeters. But when you look at more than one fibroid, that's two fibroids, when you look at patients with two fibroids, you can see that there is a significant reduction of the live birth rate from 43% to 25%. And then when they looked into the size of the myoma, it was found that when the size of the myoma is less than 3 centimeters, there is no difference in the live birth rate. But when the size of the myoma is more than 3 centimeters, the live birth rate is reduced from 34% to 17%, whether you are doing day two or day three or day five transfer, still you have the significant difference in the live birth rate. So the conclusion of this important study is that the presence of intramural fibroid not distorting the uterine cavity appears to negatively affect the clinical pregnancy and live birth rate in patients undergoing the first IVF cycle. And the deleterious effect of fibroid was significant in women with two or more fibroid and in women with fibroid more than 3 centimeters in diameter. Conversely, in women with single myoma less than 3 centimeters in diameter, there is no significant difference in the pregnancy outcome could be identified. So when we come to the important part of this presentation, that is the management of fibroid-associated infertility. How are we going to manage it? Indeed, it is not like other symptoms of which patients who have myoma complains, because in infertility, we have to make a complete infertility wake-up before we decide on the line of treatment in order to exclude other causes of infertility and ensure that the existing fibroid may be the cause of infertility, because this has an impact on the line of treatment. So we should diagnose the fibroid, whether we're using transvaginal ultrasonography, or hysterosalpingography, or saline infusion, or sonography. You also need hysteroscopy for the diagnosis of submucous fibroid. Now, when we come to the treatment available, clinical medical therapy available include GnRH agonist, GnRH antagonist, progesterone receptor agonist, and selective progesterone receptor modulator as mifepristone or uliprestal acetate, aromatase inhibitors, magnetic resonance guided focus ultrasound, or uterine artery embolization. We have to remember from the early slides that these drugs affect only temporary the size of the fibroid, and they do not eradicate the fibroid. They result in the reduction of the size of fibroid, but when you stop the treatment, then you get recurrence of the size of fibroid. The other interventions, ultrasound and uterine artery embolization, their impact and effect on infertile patients still need to be assessed with further studies evaluating the risks and benefit of these interventions. However, there is a future hope for the medical treatment because there are a lot of research is going on in this area, including the use of gene therapy for the treatment of uterine leiomyoma, also including the angiogenetic factor in the pathogenesis with the potential implication for the future therapy. And a lot of research is going in this direction. And also with the study of the impact of the growth factors on the myometrium and the myoma, including the epidermal growth factor and the platelet-driven growth factor, and also the activin and the myostatin factor. And these are hopes for the future. We hope that we have an impact on this. And then when we come to the surgical treatment, myoma are more commonly associated with other confounding factors of infertility, including advanced maternal age, long duration of infertility, tubal factor and male factor infertility, and failure of previous management. And consequently, treatment of myoma should be patient-centered and no one strategy for all, because even if the patient has the same myoma, but she has different confounding factor, then this will affect the line of treatment. The first line, of course, is myomectomy, and myomectomy is performed if myoma is the sole cause of infertility and is not associated with other confounding factor as male factor infertility or tubal factor infertility. So it is only suitable for this category of patients. Now, does the myomectomy improve the fertility or not? The answer is not very easy because of the lack of prospective randomized controlled studies. Yes, they did show some of the studies did show reduction of an increase of the pregnancy rate. However, the difference between those who removed the myoma and those who did not remove myoma was not significant. And you can see that the pregnancy rate after myomectomy varies between 24 to 72%, a very wide range, because it depends on several factors, number of fibroid, the size of fibroid, but also the most important factor, that is the age of the patient at the time of performing the myomectomy. The younger the patient, the higher is the pregnancy rate. Now, what sort of surgery we do? We do either surgical, either hysteroscopic myomectomy, abdominal myomectomy, or laparoscopic myomectomy. However, the Cochrane reviews had shown that there is no difference in the outcome and the live birth rate, whether you are performing laparoscopy or you are performing laparotomy, and of course, depend on the skills of the surgeon performing the operation. Also, Cochrane reviews showed that the only advantage of laparoscopic myomectomy is less hospital stay and less postoperative time, and the long-term effect has to be studied. Then there are another group, there's another group where myomectomy is not enough for them. You do myomectomy, and from the beginning, you say that I'm going to do myomectomy to be followed by ART. And these are the patients who have associated infertility factor as male factor or tubal factor in patient with fibroid distorting the uterine cavity. Or if the patient failed to get pregnant after myomectomy, particularly in elderly patient and patient with long-term infertility. And there are other patients who have fibroids. However, you say that I'm going to perform ART from the very beginning. And these are patients who have fibroid, which is subserous myoma, or they have a single interstitial myoma, not distorting the uterine cavity, and the size of the myoma is less than 3 centimeters. In this case, you don't need to perform myomectomy, and you go for ART because they have associated factor like advanced maternal age, long-term infertility, tubal factor infertility, or male factor infertility, and you go ahead to do ART. But sometimes you do ART, and you say to be followed by a myomectomy. And these are the patients in whom you think that myomectomy is not necessary, and you perform ART. You perform ART because they have an intramural myoma not distorting the uterine cavity, 3 to 4 centimeters, and you perform ART, and then the patient does not get pregnant after one or two trials. And then in this case, it is worthy that after you perform ART for one trial or two trials, the patient did not get pregnant, or she had a miscarriage, then you may perform myomectomy to be followed by ART. thinking that the presence of the myoma may have reduced pregnancy rate in this patient. But also there is another group where you perform an incomplete trial of IVF, you do ovarian stimulation, you do the oocyte pickup, you do the fertilization, and then you cryopreserve all the embryos, and you do myomectomy for this patient, and then after 3 to 6 months, you do deferred embryo transfer. Why? Because these are the patients who are elderly patients, and they have a very low ovarian reserve, low AMH, and you are afraid that because they have myoma distorting the uterine cavity, if you delay the IVF till you remove the myoma, and then you wait 3 to 6 months, then you might lose the remaining ovarian reserve, and the patient might not respond. And in this patient, it is worth trying that you do the pickup, you make benefit of the available ovarian reserve, get the oocyte, and then do the freeze all the embryos and do the myomectomy. And then after 3 to 6 months, you transfer, you do the deferred embryo transfer. And also the same strategy could be applied for young patients who have a small fibroid and they have a low ovarian reserve. Again, if the ovarian reserve is low, then you might do the same if the ovarian reserve is declining rapidly. So, Mr. Chairman, if I may sum up, the lines of management of myoma-associated infertility is mostly either ART or myomectomy. And the myomectomy could be either laparoscopic myomectomy, if it is two or if it is more than two fibroid, or it could be laparotomy, or if there are more fibroids, or it could be hysteroscopy if it is submucous fibroid, or it could be ART, but at the same time, it could be ART followed by myomectomy, or it could be myomectomy followed by ART. And the medical treatment might help as a preparatory line of treatment for the patient, but it does not get rid of the myoma, and its effect disappears after stopping the treatment. So the take-home message here, that women with myomas associated infertility, either myomectomy or ART, can be an appropriate first line of treatment or complementary to each other. The choice of the strategy depends upon the size, the site, the number of myomas, and the associated causes of infertility, ovarian reserve, age of the patient, the duration of infertility, outcome of previous treatment, and there is a hope to improve the safety and outcome of medical and minimal intervention therapy in future. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Professor Gamal, for a very nice talk, very comprehensive in the time allowed. Our next speaker is Professor Abubakar Nashar, Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology in Banha University.
I cannot hear.
We can hear you. There is something wrong with your speakers, with your computer. Professor, we'll defer the questions till after the lectures. Professor Abubakar Nashar is going to speak to us about recurrent pregnancy loss. Professor Nashar has a plethora of lectures available. A very eminent lecturers. His lectures have been downloaded hundreds of times, thousands of times, and we are going to hear about recurrent pregnancy loss. Professor Abubakar, please.
Thanks, Professor.
Try to stick to the time allowed, please.
Nice introduction, and you can find this lecture and more than 450 lectures on my scientific page on the Facebook, and will address recurrent pregnancy loss. I have the honor to be one of the international reviewer of the ESHRE guidelines in 2019, and that's why we will stick to these guidelines. What is the definition of recurrent pregnancy loss? If we have two or more consecutive clinical pregnancy losses until 20 weeks gestation, we should exclude the biochemical, ectopic, and molar pregnancy. This is the ASRAM definition of recurrent pregnancy loss. But in 2017, the ESHRE defined recurrent pregnancy loss if we have two or more pregnancy losses until 24 gestation. including chemical pregnancy. Recurrent miscarriage, two or more, accounts for 3%. And we have first trimester recurrent miscarriage and second trimester. First trimester accounts for 75% of repeated miscarriage. And second trimester accounts for 25% of repeated miscarriage. I would like to assure the couple that the maternal stress is not a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss. But the age has important impact, and the risk of pregnancy loss is the lowest between 20 to 35 years, but rapidly increase after the age of 40. What are the causes of recurrent pregnancy loss? We have many approach for this, but we are in the era of evidence-based medicine, and the best method for classifying the causes according to the strength of evidence. So we have a possible causes and a doubtful causes. And if there is no cause, it is called unexplained recurrent pregnancy loss, which accounts for about 50% of cases. So let us start with the possible, where there is a strong correlation between the cause and the miscarriage. And please, we will go in this sequence, because also when we are going to the investigation, we will go in the same sequence. The anatomic accounts for 10%, congenital uterine malformation, submucous fibroid. Subserous fibroid is not a cause of repeated pregnancy loss. Cervical incompetence, severe intrauterine synecdoche is a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss. What's about the endocrine? The uncontrolled diabetes, the controlled one, is not a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss. Hypothyroidism, either it is subclinical or clinical, is a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss. Infections, we have only two infections, which is a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss, brucellosis and bacterial vaginosis. The fourth is the antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. And the fifth, and this is new, there is a very good correlation between increased sperm DNA fragmentation and recurrent pregnancy loss. And lastly, genetic, which accounts for 25%. And please show this. The chromosomal abnormalities of the parents is only found in 5%, while the conceptus chromosomal abnormalities is found in about 50%. This is important when we are going to investigate our patient. This was the possible causes where there is a strong correlation between the cause and the miscarriage. What's about the second group, which is the doubtful causes where there is a weak correlation between the cause and the miscarriage? If we have premature ovarian aging, if we have aneuploidy in the embryo, and the systemic factors. And I want to lay stress that arcuate uterus, RVF uterus, mild intrauterine adhesion, subserous fibroids are not a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss. But what is new, the hydrosalpinx, all of us know that the hydrosalpinx is associated with decrease in the pregnancy in case of IVF. And also, according to the new systematic review, it was associated with recurrent pregnancy loss. The endocrine causes, we are talking about the doubtful causes, polycystic ovary syndrome, endometriosis, inadequate luteal phase, hyperprolactinemia, vitamin D deficiency, and obesity. Not only obesity, but also the underweight is a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss, and it has a negative impact on the chances of the right pairs, according to the ESHRE guidelines 2017. The inherited thrombophilic defect is a doubtful causes. The infections, chronic endometritis is a doubtful causes. The torch, please don't ask at all for torch. It is not recommended It is not one of the investigations of recurrent pregnancy loss. You are wasting the time and the money of your patient. The immunologic, like the anti-thyroid antibodies and the anti-nuclear antibodies, are a doubtful causes of recurrent pregnancy loss. The environmental and occupational factors and the habits, the heavy metals, the solvents, pesticides, the electromagnetic fields, the radiation, the smoking, the habits. Smoking has a negative impact on the chance of the live pairs. Caffeine intake, there is some studies found that there is a relation between the high intake of caffeine and delayed pregnancy loss. Alcohol, not only associated with pregnancy loss, but also it is associated with a fetal problems in the form of fetal alcohol syndrome. So this is as regards the cause. We have a possible causes, and we should first look for it, and we have a doubtful causes. We should look for it when we are exhausting, we are excluding the possible cause. For evaluation, we should start with the history, the surgical, the menstrual, the family. And I want to raise stress, and this is missed in many cases. We should ask about if there is a history of venous or arterial thrombosis, because this is one of the criteria for diagnosis of antiphospholipid syndrome. The physical examination, the signs of endocrinopathy, and to come to the investigation. We will follow the same. We will look first for the possible causes and then for the doubtful causes. And we'll start by the anatomical factors. And according to the ESHRE guidelines, we should ask for 3D ultrasonography because it is high sensitivity and specificity, and they can differentiate between septum and the bicornate uterus. And if 3D ultrasonography is not available, sonohistrography is an alternative. And don't use the hysterosalpingography because it is insensitive and it is not appropriate for evaluation of the uterine cavity. The endocrine, to ask for TSH and also for the thyroid peroxidase antibodies. And if the thyroid peroxidase antibodies or the TSH is abnormal, we should ask for T4. About the infection, to ask for the immunoglobulin M for brucellosis. The antiphospholipid syndrome, as we know the diagnosis, we should have 2 positive tests at least 12 weeks apart. Either the lupus anticoagulant, the anticardiolipin, or the anti-beta glycoprotein 1 antibodies of immunoglobulin G and immunoglobulin M, and we should have a medium or high titer or above the 99th percentile. The fifth is to look for the sperm DNA fragmentation, and we have many tests for a determination of the sperm DNA fragmentation, but the available in the market is the halosperm. And from the halosperm, we will calculate or determine the sperm DNA fragmentation index. What's about thrombophilia? According to the guidelines, don't ask for thrombophilia. Don't look for it as a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss. The karyotyping, as we mentioned, the products of conceptions are normal in 50%, and that's why we should start with the products of conception. And this only after 3 consecutive losses. And it is not routinely recommended, and only it's recommended for explanatory purposes. What is about the karyotyping of the parents? It is not routinely recommended, and it could be carried out for an individual basis only. What's about the treatment? We will start by the possible causes, and we will start by the anatomical factors. If we have congenital uterine formation in the form of septum, in this condition, hysteroscopic resection. Although there is insufficient evidence for this, and there is a systematic review found not recommending it because there is no randomized controlled studies for this. Submucosal fibroid, hysteroscopic myomectomy, severe intrauterine adhesions, hysteroscopic surgery, cervical incompetence. Let us go to the indications of cervical cerculage according to the Royal College in 2013, and we have 2 types of indication, either ultrasound indication or history indication. The ultrasound, if we have a cervical length less than 2.5 centimeter with one or more second trimester miscarriage or preterm labor before 24 weeks, this is a sound indication for cervical circulation. We can depend on the history only if we have three or more previous preterm labor and or second trimester miscarriage, this is a sound indication for cervical circulation. How to treat hypothyroidism? Eltrexin, and our objective is to keep the TSH around 2.5 milli-international unit per liter. And the dose for the non-pregnant, 1.7 microgram per kilogram per day. And if the patient got pregnant, please increase the dose by 30% immediately before doing, and don't wait the result of the TSH. What if there is the thyroid peroxidase antibodies is positive? There is no indication to give eltrexin, but it is recommended to follow up the patient when she is pregnant because this is more susceptible to hypothyroidism during the pregnancy. The euthyroid woman with thyroid antibodies, there is insufficient evidence to support treatment with eltrexin. What's about the treatment of infection? Brucellosis should be treated for 6 weeks if we are using rifampicin. And rifampicin is the dose of 900 milligram once daily. But if we want to shorten the duration, we can combine the rifampicin with trimethoprim and sulfamethoxazole for 4 weeks only. The bacterial vaginosis, the treatment is oral clindamycin early in the second trimester, 300 milligram per oral BID for 7 days. It is, according to the evidence, it is by giving the oral clindamycin significantly reduces the late miscarriage and the spontaneous preterm labor. Antiphospholipid syndrome, the treatment is a combination of low dose aspirin plus heparin. And if we have increased sperm DNA fragmentation, what's the treatment? All of us are giving oral antioxidant, but according to the guidelines, it is not associated with improvement in the life pairs. And we should lay stress on the lifestyle modification, ask them to stop smoking and to have appropriate weight, and to identify what is the cause of increased sperm DNA fragmentation. If there is infection, it should be treated. If there is varicocele, but this varicocele should be palpable and associated with the changes in the semen analysis, it should be treated. And consider the use of the TSH, but according to the recent guidelines of the British Fertility Society, they are against the use of the TSH in this condition. If we have a genetic factor in this condition, we should refer the patient to clinical genetic test. And what is about the role of the pre-implantation genetic diagnosis and IVF? Let us see if we have a translocation carrier. If we have a translocation carrier, it was found that by BGD IVF, the healthy life birth rate is 30%. But if we didn't treat them, the healthy life birth rate is more, it's 60%, so it is not recommended. And for unexplained repeated miscarriage, the BGD doesn't improve the life birth rate. So this is the treatment of the possible causes. What's about the treatment of doubtful causes? The doubtful causes like Polis-Skovar syndrome, the use of metformin is debatable. The meta-analysis found that metformin didn't reduce the recurrent pregnancy loss, but there is a small retrospective study found there is a reduction in the repeated miscarriage, and there is insufficient evidence to recommend metformin for treatment of recurrent pregnancy loss in Polis-Skovar syndrome. Hyperprolactinemia, according to one randomized controlled study, bromocriptine significantly associated with a higher rate of successful pregnancy, and that's why the guidelines recommending bromocriptine to increase the life birth rate. Vitamin D sufficiency. We should counsel the patient preconceptionally to have to consider prophylactic vitamin D supplementation. Chronic endometritis, the treatment of chronic endometritis is ofloxacine 400 milligram daily for 2 weeks, or doxycycline 100 milligram twice daily for 2 weeks. But please, to give this treatment during menstruation, because the ofloxacine and doxycycline are teratogenic. Inherited thrombophilia, not to use antithrombotic prophylaxis. This is the recommendation of the ISHRI. Don't screen for thrombophilia and don't use any antithrombotic prophylaxis for the inherited thrombophilia. What is about also a doubtful cause is the hyperhemocysteinemia, and there is no evidence there is an association between a hyperhemocysteinemia and recurrent pregnancy loss. So we did the investigation, and then in spite of this, we have no cause. And this is found in about 50%. We have no evidence-based treatment. And if we have no evidence-based treatment, we should start by the low risk, the simple, and the cheap treatment. And we should lifestyle modification, tender love and care, and progesterone, and all of this treatment modalities are ineffective. Aspirin, heparin, HCG, HMG, immunotherapy, endometrial scratching, BGD, and ICSI, all of these are ineffective. And for the lifestyle modification, to ask him to stop smoking, to minimize the caffeine less than 200 milligram per day, and to minimize alcohol or to stop alcohol, and to reduce the body mass index to have the appropriate body mass index between 20 and 30, but we have no randomized controlled studies to support this. The tender love and the care, or the psychological supportive care, what is the meaning of this? Early and frequently repeated ultrasound, beta HCG monitoring, advice concerning lifestyle and diet, emotional support in the form of counseling, and the clear policy for the upcoming 12 weeks and medication. And it is mentioned that the chance of live births is good over 50%, but again, there is no randomized controlled studies to support this. Lastly, the progesterone. And let us go to the recent systematic review and the meta-analysis, including 21 randomized controlled study. But the definition was 3 or more unexplained recurrent pregnancy loss. This is very important because according to the Cochrane systematic review, if the repeated pregnancy loss is 2, there is no effect of the progesterone, and only if it is 3 or more. And it was found that in unexplained repeated pregnancy loss, there is no significant difference in the live birth rate when we are using aspirin, low molecular weight heparin, intravenous immunoglobulin, leukocyte immune therapy, but using progesterone is effective in increasing the live birth rate, but we should start in not after conception. This is according to the recent systematic review and the meta-analysis. To come to the end, what is the prognosis? There is a model, and this model depends on the female age and the number of the previous miscarriage. And this is the relation between the number of previous pregnancy loss and the age. Increasing the age and increasing of the number of prior pregnancy loss will decrease the prognosis or associated with bad prognosis. To come to the conclusion, investigation should start after 2 consecutive miscarriages. And the recommended investigations are 4. Number 1, 3D ultrasonography or sonohistography, TSH and thyroid peroxidase antibodies, brucellosis immunoglobulin M, antiphospholipid antibodies, and we should consider sperm DNA fragmentation testing. Treatment of possible causes, if we have uterine septum, submucous fibroid, severe intrauterine adhesion, hysteroscopic surgery, cervical incompetence, cervical cerclage, subclinical hypothyroidism, eltruxin, brucellosis, rifampicin, antiphospholipid syndrome, low-dose aspirin and heparin, karyotyping abnormalities, clinical genetic test, treatment of doubtful causes, Boris Skobar syndrome, autoimmune thyroid, hyperprolactinemia, chronic endometritis, inherited thrombophilia, and the treatment of unexplained miscarriage, tender love and care, lifestyle modification, and progesterone. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Abubakar Nashar. I love the point of not to do. I think we are overusing a lot of medication, a lot of investigation, and without any clear evidence. Again, we'll keep the questions to the end of the lecture. It's my pleasure now to introduce Professor Ashraf Ortam. Professor Ashraf Ortam is a professor of obstetrics and gynecology in Shams University, a dear friend, and a very good lecturer. He's going to speak to us about antioxidants in the female in general. Please, Professor Ashraf.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It actually gives me a great pleasure to be with all of you today. And I do salute all my colleagues who are present now. I'm going to begin my speech as I'm going to speak about antioxidants in female practice. My lecture is going to involve speaking about antioxidants in the fields of infertility, pregnancy, and immunity. First of all, let us speak about oxygen. We all know that oxygen is essential for life, but like anything, when it's in excess, it becomes somewhat harmful. Because of what? Because excessive oxidation is going to elaborate free radicals with the damage of the cells. Reactive oxygen species are very important for homeostasis. They are natural byproducts of the normal metabolism of oxygen. But whenever they are in excess, they can precipitate pathologies. So reactive oxygen species can be double-edged sword. How can the excess precipitate pathologies? Concerning what? Whenever there is a disturbance in the ratio between pro-oxidants and antioxidants, there is a role in the occurrence of cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular problems, arthritis, infertility, Parkinson's disease, and asthma, amongst others. How can antioxidants work in this aspect? Actually, they can remove the free radicals, converting the reactive oxygen species to water. In addition, they can prevent lipid oxidation, which is incriminated in increasing oxidative stress. And finally, they can prevent the oxidative damage to the DNA and protein. All are very important effects. Antioxidants are various. They might be natural enzymatic. These are like the superoxide dismutase, catalase, glutathione peroxidase, and reductase. Whereas the synthetic forms are present in the micronutrients, like the vitamins, in addition to other minerals like selenium and zinc, and in addition to others. Of course, we are going to see them now. Let us go to the antioxidants regarding infertility. First of all, we all know that oxidative stress has been shown to have a fundamental role in both male and female infertility since the beginning of the 21st century. The increase in the reactive oxygen species can occur due to exogenous or endogenous factors. Concerning the exogenous factors, we do have environmental, pollution, smoking, alcohol, poor nutrition, and obesity. And of course, whenever we are going to tackle the problem of oxidative stress, we should first embark on these factors, trying to correct them. The endogenous factors involve the presence of infections, chronic and autoimmune diseases. Let's go to the female infertility, and we are going to find that oxidative stress can adversely affect the female reproduction. It can cause cell membrane lipid peroxidation, cellular oxidation, in addition to DNA damage. All are going to, of course, have a direct effect on the actively dividing cells concerning the ovary. So there will be affection of the oocyte, whether it oocyte maturation regarding the meiosis one or two, there is going to be direct effect on fertilization, implantation, and embryo. The effect of the oxidative stress doesn't go through the ovary only, but we can find it in endometriosis when we see that in peritoneal fluid, we are having excessive affection, actually. In addition to, we find it in hydrosalpinx and the polycystic ovarian syndrome and unexplained infertility. As for the polycystic ovarian syndrome, we know that oxidative stress plays an important role increasing the insulin resistance, which is a hallmark in the polycystic ovarian syndrome. As well, it has a relation to the levels of homocysteine. So if it is increased, it's going to affect both, increasing the insulin resistance in addition to increasing the homocysteine with its impact on increasing cardiovascular problem. Antioxidants can effectively reverse this, improving insulin sensitivity and decreasing the homocysteine levels. What about assisted reproduction? Reactive oxygen species can affect the embryo via alteration of gene expression. We can encounter two cell arrest of the embryos. We can encounter as well embryopathies in addition to impaired ATP production. How to go through the problem? As we said before, we should tackle first the exogenous conditions which increase reactive oxygen species, stopping smoking, stopping alcohol abuse, improving the diet, decreasing the weight in obese patients, and decreasing stress. When it comes to antioxidants, it has been shown by Showell et al. In 2017 in a recent Cochrane systemic review that the benefits of antioxidants are various. They can lower the hyperandrogenism and the insulin resistance. They can improve additionally the endometrial circulation. They have influence on both prostaglandin synthesis and steroidogenesis, in addition to favoring the presence of fertile cervical mucus. Smith et al. In 2018 showed that the use of combination of antioxidants and coenzyme 10 can increase the pregnancy rates and live birth rates in patients having polycystic ovarian syndrome. What's the role of each antioxidant here in infertility? We know that iron deficiency can affect male fertility, but as well, the overload of iron can increase oxidative stress. Zinc has a relation to the oocyte maturation and ovulation. Vitamin C is an important antioxidant that acts against oxidative stress and helps to recycle oxidized vitamin E and glutathione. Vitamin E is well known to be the strongest antioxidant present, protecting against DNA damage. And it has been claimed that women who are over 35 years of age are having deficiency in vitamin E that needs to be substituted. When it comes to provitamin A and vitamin A, it has been shown that it has good antioxidant activity, and lower concentrations in the follicular fluid of women undergoing in vitro fertilization was found to be correlated to decreased IVF success. What about selenium? In addition to being active antioxidant, it as well is important also for making other antioxidant enzymes. When you give multiple antioxidants together, they can work together better than each alone. Also, their use together can preclude the need for larger doses of any single element of them, and they can protect against oxidation of each other effectively. Let us jump to pregnancy, and we are going to find that if we look at the early pregnancy, we know that in the first 8 weeks of pregnancy, certain trophoblastic plugs are present in the spiral arterioles to protect the embryonic DNA from damage by oxidative stress. But later on, trophoblastic plugs are released. Why? Because we need the onset of placental circulation, and thereby will come the generation of oxidative stress, which if in excess can play an important role in the development of both preeclampsia and intrauterine growth retardation. But thanks God, we do have here natural antioxidant activity played by the placenta, which can secrete natural antioxidants like glutathione peroxidase, selenoproteins, and superoxide dismutase. As we see here, the presence of certain elements like selenium, copper, zinc, and manganese are very important for these to act properly. Whenever this action is deficient, we can be encountered with preeclampsia and which culminating in intrauterine growth retardation. And we are going to see that this intrauterine growth retardation is also incriminated in what happens later on for the neonate when he becomes in his adult life. How come? We are going to see it in the next slide, but here, oxidative stress doesn't only affect increase in the preeclampsia, but it also has certain actions, increasing abortion, high datiform mole, and recurrent pregnancy loss. This occurs whenever pro-oxidants or reactive oxygen species are in excess compared to antioxidants. If we don't have enough antioxidants, the oxidative stress will increase, and there is going to be some sort of biological competition between the mother and the conceptus. And so both are going to be affected adversely with poor pregnancy outcome and increase in the metabolic syndrome. As we see here, there is a new concept called the fetal programming effect. And it says that what happens to the fetus in utero is going to affect this fetus whenever delivered and he becomes in the third or fourth decade by problems later on. Those who were born with intrauterine growth retardation, small for date, or those who were born obese, both were amenable later on in adult life to what's called the metabolic syndrome, with its all its elements like the diabetes mellitus and cardiovascular disease and otherwise. Somebody is going to ask me, what's the relation between what happens in utero and diabetes mellitus to occur later? As an example, if you see the last one here in this slide, you are going to find that pancreatic cells are susceptible to oxidative stress, and this can affect the pancreatic function and insulin additionally. And so we know here now that there is a link between the metabolic syndrome and what happens early during the intrauterine life. So it's very important to supplement the antioxidants from the start, trying to protect the woman from decrease in antioxidants if they are not present naturally in enough amounts to protect the conceptus or the offspring from acquisition of certain diseases during adulthood age. Does the woman need antioxidants in excess during pregnancy? Yes. Are we going to exceed the upper limits? Never ever, because the upper limits are too far away to affect this woman. But in pregnancy, we do need additional antioxidants. This can be acquired either from a healthy diet, but this is not sure that we are going to have it. And so supplementation might be important in this respect. What's the role of certain elements here, apart from the iron and folic acid, which are very well known? Vitamin A is known to have an affection of the eye development. But if in excess of 9,000 international units supplemented per day, it's going to be teratogenic. Zinc is very important with deficiency causing abortion and congenital malformations if it is severe. But if it's mild to moderate, we are going to have the problems that occur in late pregnancy, like preterm birth, low birth weight, intrauterine growth retardation, and the need for assisted delivery whenever the woman delivers. Magnesium was shown by Zota et al. In 2017 to reduce small for gestational age birth by 30%. And vitamin D, I think Professor Abu Bakr Mashar spoke about it. The deficiency of vitamin D has been claimed that it might increase the risk of preeclampsia by 5 times, in addition to affection of the newborn by neonatal rickets and infantile rickets. And for selenium is well known to decrease early pregnancy loss and risk of preeclampsia, and it's essential for the production of thyroid hormones. But what's most important is the iodine, bearing in mind that the severe deficiency can cause abortion, stillbirth, and cretinism, and mild to moderate deficiency can cause iodine deficiency disorders. You can know that there will be a 73% decreased risk of acquisition of cretinism by the age of 4 years if the woman is to be supplemented with iodine. Omega-3 is not far from these ones, and many studies have spoken about the benefits of omega-3, but without the evidence, of course, but they have spoken about decreasing the risk of preeclampsia, preterm birth, postpartum depression, in addition to increasing the weights by about, in average, 200 grams of the feti and fetal brain development. for childhood, there has been given a great care to giving or supplementation of omega-3 to children because it improves vision and IQ at the age of 4 and decreases the allergy and asthma. Let's come to the last one, and we are going to speak about the antioxidants and immunity. Micronutrient deficiency can affect the immunity, both the cell-mediated and the humoral immunity. And the supplementation of antioxidants has been shown to be effective in improving the immune response and decreasing the cell injury. For individual antioxidants, we find that we know that zinc is important for the development and maintenance of the immune cells, and its deficiency was shown to affect both humoral and cell-mediated immunity. Zinc being intracellular in good amounts can impair the replication of variety of viruses. And in 2020, Derwent and Scholes found or reported that higher levels of intracellular zinc can affect or inhibit the replication of the COVID virus. And that from here came the rationale of using the zinc with hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine for treatment or decreasing the effects of COVID-19 virus. If zinc is deficient, the thymus is going not to function properly. T cell mediated immunity is going to be affected with increased susceptibility to infections. Iron is no less important. It's very important as having growth promoting factors, growth promoting and differentiation inducing properties. But its deficiency is known to impair cell mediated immunity. The problem is that both the host and pathogen need iron, and so deficiency can impair the host immunity, while overload can cause oxidative stress that propagates harmful viral mutation. So a delicate balance of how to give iron and in what amounts is very important. Here, if we look to the other factors acting on the immunity, we are going to find that vitamin A makes the uninfected cells refractory from being attacked by viral replication. Vitamin C is a very important antioxidant, and it lowers the complication, respiratory complications like pneumonia. And from here came the concept about how about using it to decrease the complication, the respiratory complications of the COVID virus, like pneumonia as well. Vitamin B is well known to have strong anti-inflammatory effect in addition to enhancement of the immune system. And vitamin D affects the maturation and the immune cells. And it has been claimed that in COVID-19 virus patients, infected patients, Zhang et al. Reported that these women might have vitamin D deficiency. So supplementation here is important. This is the slide before the last one. And it speaks about omega-3 and omega-6 being having anti-inflammatory and pro-inflammatory effects and decreasing the replication of other viruses. Potentially, they could be having a positive effect on COVID virus. Selenium, its deficiency can impair or induces the rapid mutation of benign variants of the viruses to virulent. And so we need it importantly. And finally, vitamin E is a very important antioxidant, and it has been claimed that its deficiency in bovine, in calves, it can be incriminated in causing them to have bovine coronavirus infections. In conclusion, we know that oxidative stress now has impact on fertility, pregnancy, and immunity. The use of antioxidants has a potential role to improve the fertility outcomes. Additionally, the antioxidants remain important during and after pregnancy, coping with the onset of adult chronic diseases induced by oxidative stress. And finally, oxidative antioxidants play a very important and crucial role in the function of the immune system. How to give it? In addition, we should first embark on giving dietary strategies, but if dietary strategies are not going to be sufficient, and they will not be sufficient in most of the patients, micronutrient supplementation is going to be having important effect to supply the woman with antioxidants, and it should be given to optimize nutrition. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Ashraf, for a very comprehensive talk about antioxidants. Our last speaker is Professor Mohammed Salama, Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Hunafiya University. He is going to speak to us about what's happening today with the COVID status and how it affects the production. And this is actually is the mode of the day. We think that COVID has gone. It doesn't. It's going to stay with us apparently for quite some time. Professor Salama, please proceed.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بداية بتوجه بخل الشكر والتحية للجمعية المصرية للخصوبة والعقم وأساتذة الكرماء على رأسهم معالي الدكتور رب سرور دكتور محمد يحيى والزملاء الأفاضل دكتور بكر والكريم الفاضل الدكتور أشرف كورتام. لا يفوتني برضو إلا أن أرحب بالزملاء الأعزاء الحضور وما شاء الله ما شاء الله عددهم أكثر من 380 زميل فيا أهلا بيكم. الموضوع زي ما قال الدكتور محمد يحيى من الموضوعات اللي بتواكب الحدث كورونا فيروس أو الكوفيد 19 is caused by a new strain of coronavirus.
Professor Salama, ممكن حضرتك تدوس على سكرين شو تحت الايكون على اليمين خالص لو سمحت. احنا دلوقتي عندنا ال editing view
سكرين شو فين ما نمش
في هتلاقي على اليمين خالص تحت في البرزنتيشن نفسها
أيوة.
السكرين شو زي ما بنعمل عادي خالص في أيوة.
باين عندي دكتور محمد
في البرزنتيشن نفسها دي
الكاسه
الكاسه
مش باين عندي بامان
خليها فول سكرين لا 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 تحت خالص على اليمين يا دكتور محمد
مش باينة يا دكتور محمد
الباور بوينت يا دكتور محمد
ممكن دكتور خالد
السلايدز باينة
بروفيسور سلايد من فوق السلايد شو بس
فين يا
معايا يا مصطفى
فين حبيبي انا مش
بروفيسور سلام حضرتك فوق في الايقونات جنب الانيميشن في سلايد شو سبع حاجه بعد
انيميشن فوق سلايد شو يا ايون كده يا دكتور محمد
كده تمام
تمام
ماشي بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم معذرة للزملاء النهاردة أنا هتكلم على الكوفيد 19 and reproduction زي ما بقول إن ده بيواكب الحدث والأحداث الجارية وحقيقة الأمر هو له دبل بينيفيت في التخصص والحاجة الثانية إن إحنا بنواكب الحدث we will know how can we protect ourselves كورونا فيروس أو الكوفيد 19 is caused by a new strain first identified in Wuhan in China. في 30 يناير 2020 الـ WHO declared the COVID outbreak to be a global public emergency. وده اعتبر السادس جائحة بعد حاجات سبقته زي H1N1 والبوليو والإيبولا في الأفريكا والزيكا والإيبولا في Republic of Congo. في مارس في 11 مارس السنه دي ال WHO announced the current COVID outbreak as pandemic. Currently there are more than 8.5 million confirmed cases globally identified. ده لحد 19 جون 2020. We're number increasing rapidly up till now وفي rebound في بعض الدول. ايه الوضع في مصر لحد امبارح 23 جولاي اكتر من 90,000 cases diagnosed infected versus 4,500 deaths لحد امبارح طب ايه هو الالترا ستراكشر اوف كوفيد 19 فيروس؟ هو ار ان اي فيروس سراوندد باي ميمبرين اوف جلايكوبروتين. الميمبرين ده وفي له حاجه اسمها سبايك عامله زي الكراون. السبايكس دي مهمه جدا بالنسبه للفيروس لما بتيجي تعمل بنتريشن للسيلز اللي هو بيحبها مينلي النيوموسايتس. عندنا تو سايتس الاي سي اي ريسبتور والتي ام بي ار اس ريسبتور. الاي سي اي ريسبتور ده بيساعد في الانتري اوف ذا فيروس والتي ام بي ار اس اس ده بيساعد على الريبليكيشن بعد ما بيدخل السيل، لان احنا زي ما احنا فاهمين هو بيبقى على السيرفيس خامل لا يتكاثر، ولكن بمجرد دخوله الخليه بيحصل تكاثر شديد جدا بطريقه في منتهى الغباء. الكلاسيفيكيشن اوف ذا ديزيز سيفيريتي في اسيمتوماتيك اور بري سيمتوماتيك، ودي بيقولوا بتبقى موجوده في حوالي 80%. في مايلد كيسز اللي بتبقى دايجنوزد از فلو وبتعدي برضه، ودي بتبقى موجوده في حوالي 10%. ال 10% الباقيين بيبقى مودريت انلس وسيفير انلس، والكريتيكال كيسز الله لا يقدر حوالي 2% اللي بيحصل لهم ديس. طب ايه هو الفرق بين الكوفيد 19 والفلو؟ باختصار شديد الباثوفيسيولوجي والابيدوميولوجي والترانسميشن بتاع والديناميكس اوف كوفيد 19 نوت فولي اندرستود. وزي ما شفنا كل يوم حتى الـ WHO تطلع تقرير وتنفيه ويثبت عدم صحته في حاجات كتيرة قوي قوي. كمان في الوقت نفسه currently ما فيش specific medication ولا treatment identified up till now للكوفيد 19. وat this time it is unclear whether a new drug اللي هو الرميدا سيفير ممكن يستخدم safely في البريجننت والبريست فيدينج وومن. كمان من خطورته ان الكوفيد 19 is a novel infection new to humans and the host immunity is assumed to be minimal. وده اللي يؤكد هذا طلعت مودة استخدام البلازما، وطلع ان اكثر حاجة ممكن تبقى last immunity في اللي هو البست انفكتد ما بتتعداش 90 يوم. الكوفيد 19 كمان الانفكشن ريت بتاعه بيبقى عالي جدا عن الفلو، ومن 10 ل 15 فولد جريتر مورتاليتي ريت زان الفلو. ولشديد الاسف بنسمع والمورتاليتي امونج الانفكتد دكتورز ودي حاجه مؤسفه يصل حوالي 4.2%، وده يمثل 10 اضعاف النسبه العالميه في البلاد الاخرى. ده بينقلنا للمود اوف ترانسميشن. اب تيل ناو في 3 بروفن روتس للترانسميشن. الفيرست دايركتلي ثرو الدروبلتس، والدروبلتس دي بتنتهي بتدخل ثرو ذا اي والماوس والنوز، وبتبقى السبريد هايلي انفكشوس ويزن 2 متر ديستانس. الاندايركت دروبلتس دي تيجي على الهارد سيرفيس والانسان ياخدها بالتاتش وينقلها لنفسه عن طريق ان ايديه تيجي تلمس الفم او النوز او الاي. اخيرا من حوالي اسبوعين فقط قالوا the newly identified and proven route اللي هو الايربورن ترانسميشن، وقالوا ان في certain factor بتؤثر على الترانسميشن إذا كان المكان open ولا closed والduration of stay والحاجة اسمها الفيرال load، بمعنى كم واحد infected وأنا موجود بينهم، وده قد يفسر انتشار العدوى بين الأطباء في الثياترز لأنها بتبقى غرف مغلقة والحالات even mild ما بتبقاش undiagnosed. الدياجنوز اوف كوفيد 19 مينلي بيزد على السي تي والريفرس والبي سي ار اللي هو الار تي بي سي ار. البي سي ار غالي ومش افيلابل اول ذا تايم، ففي سيرتين كيسز بيبقى السي تي سكان كونسيدرد مور سينستيف أكتر من RT-PCR, ولكن PCR is mainly to confirm the diagnosis. الحاجة التانية إن في حاجات سمعنا عن الرابيد تيست, والرابيد تيست ثبت إنه unvaluable, ولكن هي بيشخص إن في recent infection أو ما فيش, بالإضافة على إن حساسية هذا الاختبار اللي هو الاي جي جي والاي جي ام مش موجودة, وبوجه عام ليس هناك توصية أن يجرى. في مجموعة investigation تانية كلنا بنسمع عنها, السي بي سي, فوجد إن في ليمفوبينيا بتبقى موجودة في بعض الحالات في الايرلي ستيجز, بيستخدموا الانفلاماتوري ماركر, وعندنا هنا السيرا اكتف بروتين والسيرام فيريتين, دول ماركرز قد يستخدموا في التشخيص. الليفر انزيمز لما بتتعمل على اساس اليوز اوف ادجوفانت سايتوتوكسيك دراجز, الهيباتوتوكسيك دراجز اللي ممكن تستخدم, فبتبقى معانا مهمه كبيز لاين. في طبعا بنسمع عن انفستيجيشن كتيره, لكن اللي انا بقوله او اللي قلته ده اهم الانفستيجيشن. الجماعه بتوع الراديولوجي عملوا كلاسيفيكيشن وجريدز للسي تي اوف ذا شيست, ودول اربعه جريد اللي هي الايكويفوكال او النوت شور فور دايجنوزيس, وللادفانسد كيس والسيفير كيس والديسيبيتيشن ستيج او التيرمينال ستيج, ودي صور معروفة عند حاليا في كل مراكز الراديولوجي, وفي هاي ريلايابيليتي عليها, لدرجة ان في السيفير سيمتوماتايزنج كيزز بتتعمل هي وبيكان باس البي سي ار في معظم الحالات. ده بيودينا, قلنا ان مفيش ايدنتيفايد تريتمنت اب تيل ناو, والاميونيتي شورت لاستنج, فالبريفنشن از ذا بيست سوليوشن, والبراكتس اوف ريسبيراتوري هايجين والوير اوف ذا ماسك دول والديستانسينج والستين هوم دولت بيعتبروا, ومع النظافه الشخصيه طبعا بيعتبروا دي المين ويبون في البروتكشن. فالدبليو اتش ام طلع فلايرز كتيره قوي, زي نمره واحد افويد الكونتاكت ويز بيبل هو ار ات ريسك, هنقول لهم, وافويد التاتشنج يور اي والنوز والماوس, وعرفنا السبب, واثناء العطس او الكحه يا اما في منديل او في جيبك اللي هو الصدر او بتغطيه بكوعك, كفر يور كف وسنيز وذا تيشو, وكلين فريكوينتلي التاتشد اوبجكت, وطبعا الهاند ووش على الاقل 20 ثانيه بالصابون العادي, لان بيدوب الجلايكوبروتين كود بتاع الفيروس وبيموته, ودي حاجات مهمه قوي. واضافت اخيرا دبليو اتش او ان الكوكينج الفود يبقى ويل كوكت سبيشيالي الميت, زي ما حكى الدكتور اشرف, وي هاف تو انهانس ذا اميونيتي, والانهانسينج اوف اميونيتي نوت ثرو ذا دراج اونلي, ولكن وي هاف تو ايت ذا رايت دايت. الرايت دايت مينلي كل الجرين فيجيتابلز والفريش فروتس سبيشيالي السيترس فروتس, والحاجات اللي بتزود المناعه بنسبه عاليه الزبادي, الهول جرينز, واللين والافوكادو والبينز واللينن والإجز والجرين فيجيتابل والسي فيش. الحاجات دي مهمة جدا, وإنها بتزود الإميونيتي, وإذا كان يصعب الحصول عليها فيفضل إنك تستخدم supplementation of enhancing immunity لسام دراجز. فبرضو الهيلثي فود ريتش ان فوليك اسيد ار ا ماست, ودي كل الكالر دي فود مصادر غنيه جدا لفيتامين سي والزنك وفيتامين دي زي ما اشار زملائنا. في الوقت نفسه اذا كان العزله مطلوبه استين هوم, لكن لازم الفيزيكال اكتيفيتي ماست بي دان, even walking in a wide area في الصالة, حوالي في الحديقة بتاع المنزل, في الشارع بالليل, لأن الكلام ده بيريليف الستريس وبيجيت سام فريش اير اند فيتامين دي لو كان معمول بالنهار وسيفلي كونكت ويز اذر. ودي حاجه مهمه قوي. لو لقينا بقى الموضوعنا اللي هو كوفيد 19 اند ريبرودكشن، اول حاجه طلع استادي من تشاينا بتقول ان السبيرم سبريد الكوفيد 19 وده ديتكتد في السبيرمز الكوفيد وجدوه في السبيرمز بتاع الانفكتد بيرس، وطلعت نكت وحكايات ومزاح كبير قوي حوالين هذا الموضوع. في جون 2020 الفيرتيليتي والستيريليتي ريبورت انديكيتد ان في ديكريز سبيرم كونسنتريشن اند موتيليتي فور ات ليست 3 مانثز او 19 دايز فولوينج الانفكشن ويز كوفيد 19. ودي دراسه معموله ومنشوره في الفيرتيليتي والستيريليتي. السبيرم كونتينج كورونا فيروس ده عمل كويتشن مارك كبيره، هل هو ممكن يبقى سيكشوال ترانسميتد ولا لا للتشاينيز ستادي، ولكن ما وصلوش لكونكلوجن نهائي. ولكن الكونكلوجن قالوا ان الفيروس ريسبونسبل فور كوفيد 19 بيدينا سيفير اكيوت ريسبيراتوري سيندروم. كورونا فيروس هاز بين ديتكتد ان ستول والجي اي تي والسلايفا واليورين سامبل ومنهم كمان السيمن. الستيريليتي والانفيرتيليتي ماجازين 2020 في العدد المذكور ده قالوا ان الكورونا فيروس ديزيز انفيكشن may affect adversely some pregnant women and their offspring. وفي additional ولكن التوصية على أساس الديوريشن قليل من أول يناير لحد الآن ما بقاش فيه 9 أشهر حمل كاملين علشان يقدروا يعملوا تقييم كامل على مستوى العالم. وعلشان كده كانت التوصية إن في additional studies are needed to assess the effect of COVID-19 on male and female infertility. الأوروبيان الإشري قالوا توصية واضحة جدا ودي طلعت في أول الجائحة 14 مارس، قالوا كل الفيرتيليتي بيشنت considering or planning treatment حتى الدياجنوستيك كريتيريا تبقى must be banned لأن البريجنانسي مش مستحب at this time. الإكسي ريكومنديشن من الأسرم قالوا we have to suspend a new treatment cycles when cancel كل الإمبريو ترانسفيرز وسسبنشن كمان للإلكتف سيرجري اللي هي enhancing fertility. كل دي ريكومنديشن وريكومنديشن مش سوليد قوي ولكن مبنية على احتمال ان الفير لو حصل بريجنانسي ممكن يحصل كونجينيتال انوماليز ودي مش معروفه للان. وحتى لو ما حصلش كونجينيتال انوماليز الريت اوف ابورشن والجروث اوف ذا فيتس ان يوترو كان بي افكتد. ولكن طلعت واضحه جدا الاسرم طلع ريكومنديشن ان احنا وي هاف تو سسبند النيو تريتمنت سايكل وين كانسل الامبريو ترانسفيرز ايذر فريش او فروزن ونعمل سسبنشن للإلكتف سيرجري. وكانت زي ما موجود في أسفل الشريحة كده قالوا إن الإمباكت of potential risk of COVID-19 on pregnancy والفيتس والchild well-being غير معلوم وعلشان كده it is better to suspend even حتى الـ IUI والـ IVF cycle وكل التريتمنت موداليتيز. طبعا علشان بقى الموضوع يعني يبقى سوليد في ريكومنديشن واحنا بنحترم الريكومنديشن لانها بتبقى مبنيه على اساس علمي. الاشري جايد لاينز ريكومندد الاي ار تي تريتمنت في ابريل 2020 وتحت الايتم ده ناقشهم 6 نقط. نمره 1 الدسكشن والاجريمنت والكونسنت اوف تريتمنت والستاف اند بيشنت ترياج والاكسس تو ادفايس اند تريتمنت والادابتيشن اوف اي ار تي سيرفيسز والتريتمنت سايكل بلاننج والكود اوف كوندكت فور ذا ستاف اند ذا بيشنت. هنشوفهم واحده واحده بمنتهى البساطه. نمره واحد، ان احنا عندنا هاي ريسك بيشنت، كلنا متعارفين ان دايابيتكس والهايبرتنسيف والناس اللي بيوزنج اللي بيستخدموا اميونو سبريسيف ثيرابي والباست ترانسبلانت بيشنت للكيدني او الليفر، وكل دولت بنعتبرهم هاي ريسك في الفرتايل ايج. فالهاي ريسك دولت الادفايس ما تقرب لهمش ولا تساعدهم خالص باي ار تي، باي ار تي بروجرام في الوقت الحالي. الحاجه الثانيه قالوا ان كل البيشنت ماست بي اوفر ذا تشويس، لازم في الكونسلنج نشرح لهم سواء كانوا هم بقى هاي ريسك او لو ريسك، نشرح لهم ان الاوت كام وكانت جارانتي. وعلشان كده الاي ار تي تريتمنت اوبشن باختيارهم هم وبيكونسنت على كده. والبيشنت مانس كومبرهنسيفلي انفورمد وكليرلي اندرستاند الريسك ريليت للكوفيد 19 ديزيز والانكريز دي ريسك اوف انفيكشن كمان ديورنج بريجننسي. يعني مش لو حتى عدت ان البريجننسي نفسه من الاميون سبريسيف فيسيولوجيك تشينجز ممكن يبقوا هاي لو اميونيتي وريسكي فور انفيكشن. بعد ما بنشرح هذا الكلام قالوا ان البيشنت ماست كونسنت ماست ساين اند ادير تو ذا كود اوف كوندكت. تاني حاجه البروسيدر فور ذا بيشنت، قبل كل البيشنت البلاننج تو ستارت تريتمنت لهم حاجه اسمها تراياج اوف كوتشينير ثرو الميل او الفون. وبصراحه هي حاجه سهله جدا هنشوفها دلوقتي. والكلام ده بيبدا اسبوعين قبل ما يدخلوا السايكل، والبريليمينري ترياج بيرفورم 2 ويكس قبل الاي ار تي بروجرام، وبيعملوا فيرزر ترياج كمان للبارتنر اثناء الاوفيريان استيميوليشن بروجرام. والبيشنت سسبكتد اوف انفيكشن افتر ذس ترياج شود جيت ريجولار كوفيد 19 الاي جي جي والاي جي ام تيستينج او اي ايكويفالنت تيست لتو بي شور انهم نوت انفيكتد. اخر حاجه ان البيشنت اوز بريفيوس كونفيرمد كوفيد انفيكشن ات شود بريزنت ميديكال ايفيدنس اوف كليرنس، يعني لازم يتعمل يبقوا كلينيكالي فري اوف ذا ديزيز، وفي الوقت نفسه يبقى عندنا بي سي ار بيقول انه بقى نيجاتيف بعد ما كان بوزيتيف قبل ما نبدا ليهم. الترياج ده سواء كان للستاف او للبيشنت اتعمل في الصوره الجميله دي في صوره كوتشينير. هننتهي في النهايه ان ممكن يبقى اسيمتوماتيك والترياج نيجاتيف وده اشتغل معاهم على طول، او مايلد او نون سبيسيفيك سيمتومز الترياج دولت بنقول عليهم بوتنشيالي بوزيتيف، ده لازم وي هاف تو تيست للكوفيد 19 ايفن باي الاي جي ام والاي جي جي. لو طلع بوزيتيف لازم نحولهم الكوبيشنال هيلث ادفايس والسيلف كارانتين، او بمعنى اخر يكملوا بقى البروتوكول ان يتعمل لهم البي سي ار. ولو كانت الترياج نتيجته من البدايه ان في سبيسيفيك سيمتومز للكوفيد 19 دولت بوزيتيف برضو بنعزلهم وينسوا الموضوع بتاع الاي ار تي في الوقت الحالي. البيشنت ترياج هو نفسه الترياج اللي احنا بنقوله لازم يبقى كمان للستاف. فالترياج بيبقى في النهاية عندنا ثلاثة سيناريو. السيناريو الأولاني انهم كويسين جدا ممكن يكملوا. السيناريو الثاني انه بقى بوردر لاين او كويري، ده على حسب اختيارهم وبنعمل الرابيد تيست. السيناريو الأخير انهم بروف دولت نبعد عنهم خالص ماست بي اكسكلودد. تالت ايتم من الريكومنديشن بتاع الاشري بنقول we have to assist to advise and treatment، بمعنى البيرسونال اثناء العلاج في البي بي اي بروتكشن اللي هو البيرسونال بروتكتيف اكويبمنت. ولازم دي احنا نعيها كاطباء لان دي من احد الاسباب القويه بتاع الميديكال بيرسونيل انفيكشن ان هم نوت ادهير للبي بي اي سيستم فور بروتكشن. الحاجة التانية السوشيال ديستانسينج، مش شرط يبقى كل التيم موجود مع العيانة، لا، we have to minimize التيم أثناء البروسيدر، we avoid كمان unnecessary human physical contact، والقمبين اللي هم اللي بيبقوا مع العيانة دولت بيستبعدوا نهائي وما يجوش. وفي الوقت نفسه لازم تبقى البيشنت والدكتور أوير من السيمتومز. أنا للأسف النهاردة جاي عيانة بتقول لي sorry my doctor I have to tell you that I have a COVID during cesarean section. طبعا أنا بلمت وأنا قاعد الكلام ده من عاملة سيكشن من 9 أيام وبتقول لي أنا مرضيتش أقول لك وأنا عندي كوفيد. طبعا ده اللي احنا بنتعرض له. طيب البي بي اي ده نظامه ايه؟ لازم مش مجرد بدلة ولا مجرد ماسك، لا، ده حاجات اتعمل عليها استاديز كتيرة جدا واتدرس قد ايه البروتكشن، ولها نظام في اللبس ونظام في الخلع، ولكن هي على بعضها لا تختلف ان لها 9 حاجات اللي هم في الصورة دول: بدلة كاملة وميديكال كاب وفيس شيل وجوجل نظارة كمان وسيرجيكال ماسك 3 لايرز، والافضل كمان انه يبقى N95 ماسك، ولازم شوز كفر وليج كفر بالليج قبل الشوز، وديسبوزابل جلاف بيستخدم احنا السيرجيكال جلاف وذ هاي بروتكشن، وطبعا لازم يبقى معانا الكحول جيل او الكحول سبراي. واهم من ده وده ان مش ده يبقى متاح وبس، لا، لازم نتعلم كويس قوي ونتدرب على طريقه اللبس والخلع للبي بي اي سيستم اللي هو البيرسونال بروتكتيف اكويبمنت. رابع نقطة على حسب الإشري بيقول adaptation of ART surface، بمعنى treatment of each patient it should be completely re-thought and individualized. مش قرآن، مش بروتوكول هيتطبق على كل الناس، لا، ده احنا ممكن نعمل modification أثناء السايكل على حسب الأحداث اللي هتتم in order to reduce the unnecessary visit والstaff patient contact. ممكن نستخدم التليميديسين، ودي حاجة يعني الحاجات اللي نقدر نعمل كواتشينير أو الترياج ده عن طريق الكمبيوتر أو النت ممكن يساعدنا قوي إنه يقلل الدايركت contact. ولازم يبقى فيه guidance وadaptation للسيرفيس سنتر، ودولت بيلخصوهم في 3 نقط: نمرة 1 good sanitation، نمرة 2 staff and center adaptation، نمرة 3 access to the procedure. لازم في steps تبقى معروفة العيان have to follow اللي هي بنقول عليها المسارات الآمنة للدخول والخروج في السنتر. طبعا ده ما ينفعش في سنتر صغير، لازم السنتر اللي يتعمل له modification يبقى سنتر مساحته كبيرة ويتعمل له زي بارتيشن للدخول والخروج وتيسير الأمور تقليلا للعدوى. بالنسبة بقى النقطة المهمة جدا اللي هي 5 نقطة في الإشري اللي هو التريتمنت سايت. احنا قلنا 2 أسبوع قبل الستارت اوف تريتمنت هيبقى عندنا 1 من 3 سيناريو، يا إما فري أو بوردر لاين أو انفكتد. انفكتد بيستبعد على طول أو بوست بون. البوردر لاين بنعمل الرابيد تيست، لو طلع بوزيتيف برضه بوست بون. اللي هنشتغل عليهم الفري والبوردر لاين ما فيهوش كونفيرميشن، بيتعمل ترياش تاني للكوتشينير وستارت الاوفيريان ستيميوليشن، والبروتوكول بيستخدم الستاندرد بروسيدر دون اي خلاف عن السابق. لما بنيجي بقى للحاجات اللي فيها انترفينشن، الاوسايت ريتريفال بنستخدم برضو الستاندرد بروكوشن في الحالات العادية. في الحالات البوردر لاين ممكن نستخدم الستاندرد بروكوشن، أو لو طلع بوزيتيف في الرابيد تيست بوست بون. الثالث طبعا ده من البداية بنؤجله، ما بنكملش معاه. آخر حاجة الكود اوف كوندكت فور ذا ستاف اند ذا بيشنت، لازم تبقى الأمور واضحة جدا للستاف ممبر والبيشنت. ماست بي انستراكتد to avoid unnecessary exposure، يا إما في الورك أو في البرايفت حتى في معانا. الوقت نفسه each surface will prepare compulsory instruction for the staff. الانستراكشن we have to follow لان الغلطه لها ضحايا ومتاسف بعيد وزيد بقينا اكثر من 150 طبيب ميتين واكثر من 1000 طبيب مصابين والاصابات بين اطباء امراض النساء كبيره جدا جدا مع ان المتوقع انها تبقى في الامراض البطنه والصدريه لكن لشديد الاسف العكس هو الحادث وله تفسيرات كثيره قوي منها عدم الادهيرنس للانستراكشن بنستسهل restricted social life and interaction مهم هذا الكلام ال patient should sign regularly that they are well and have respected the code لازم هي تبقى فاهمة ما فيهاش مجاملة لازم تفولو وهي ماضية من البداية على الكود والستاف ممبر طبعا بلا شك هم المسألة في التطبيق حصل الخير وحملت الست في نهاية البرنامج الحمل زي ما بيتقال occurrence of pregnancy مع من خلال رابطة الزواج ده حق أصيل للجيرلز والوومن ولازم بيقولوا يبقى في الفرونت سنتر ولازم ده حتى بيعتبروه emergency response ولكن لازم نحمي الناس دي إزاي؟ لازم all the time وهي حامل stay safe وstay alert to avoid الانفكشن الله لا يقدر الانفكشن طب ايه الريكومنديشن بتاع الـ WHO باللي بالنسبة لأثناء البريجنانسي الريكومنديشن up till now الavailable data on the effect of COVID-19 on pregnancy and childbirth and breastfeeding are sparse حاجات معلومات كده متجمعة من الشمال واليمين ومش confirmed في النهاية ولكن بيؤكدوا على الريسبكت الأمانة والdistancing ولازم نستخدم بعض الدراجز هو ملهوش identified drugs sure drug للتريتمنت لكن نستخدم immune enhancing drug وضيط وبين ريليف استراتيجي والمور سيف اللي هو طبعا نونستيرويد الانتي انفلاماتوري كومبليتلي بروهيبيتد حتى لو في كويري انها فلو مش كوفيد ما تستخدمش والموست سيف اند بروفن دراج تو بي يوز البارا سيتامول ده بالنسبه للحمل طب هل الناس دي حملت هيتابعوا ازاي هيقولنا على حسب الريجولار فيزيت لا ده في حاجة اسمها during the COVID pandemic عملوا السيرفيس كود بيدليفرد فيا التليميديسين عن طريق النت والتليفون ممكن الست في بنقول لها ان في warning alarming signs اثناء البريجنس لو حصلت هي اللي هتيجي تزور الكلينيك وما عدا هذا بتعمل لها كل حاجة الانستراكشن تديها لها باي تليفون او النت وبرضو أي أدفايس بنديها لها بهذا الطريق والكلام ده على فكرة السيرفيس ديليفرد ديورينج البريجنانسي ده في البرينيتال والبوست بارتم وكل ده على حسب الألوان والدليل بتاعه اللي هو تحت ده بيبقى التليفون هي أي وقت الولادة إحنا we have to attend delivery ولها special precaution وربنا الحافظ طيب البريجننت فون ترياج هي حملت وعدت مننا وقاعدة في البيت الترياج اللي هنسألها عنه ايه في سكرينينج كويتشن نمرة واحد do you have fever او respiratory symptoms كتير قوي بتقول لك انا اصل بنام في المروحة اصل بفتح التكييف اصل خدت دوش كل ده كلام بيبقى misleading الحاجة التانية Have you had contact with suspected or confirmed case of COVID-19؟ ودي مهمة قوي وده يعتبر من الأسئلة المهمة جداً جداً. لو السؤال الأولاني yes وفي symptoms والsymptoms دي mild أو moderate we have to direct the patient إنها تروح لتعمل test وfollow up. السيمتومز زي ما قلناها ثلاثة مايلد أو مودريت أو سيفير المايلد أفيبرايل ونيو كاف المودريت نيو فيفر ونيو كاف السيفير شيست بين وشورتنس أوف بريث لو الكويتشن واحد سيفير سيمتومز على طول لازم تبقى هوسبيتال عزل مباشره وهوسبيتاليزيشن وتاخد التريتمنت. لو الكويتشن 2 اللي هي كونتاكت بالسسبكتد او كونفيرمد كيس دي بنعتبرها مباشره انها انفكتد انتل بروفد اذروايز. طب هنولدها على حسب الرويال كوليدج قالوا 7 انستراكشن لازم يبقى فيه شيست سبيشاليست وانترنست واوبستريشن طب يبقى ويل ترين واليرت ولازم واحد بتاع انستيزيا يبقى افيلابل كويس جدا ولو هتحتاج انستيزيا مور بيتر انها تبقى سباينال ولازم طبعا يبقى فيه واحد بتاع نيوناتولوجي وبتاع مايكروبيولوجي والانفكشن كنترول سيستم في لازم يتبلغ وهنتعامل معاها بميديكال او اوبستاتريكال. الميديكال زي البروتوكولز العاديه ما بتختلفش نهائي في اي حاجه. الاوبستاتريك على حسب الاوبستاتريك انديكيشن يعني ما بيحصل لهاش موديفيكيشن الا بالبي بي اي سيستم. طيب في ستاديز بقى بتبين لنا الحال الوقت الحالي ما فيش ايفيدنس ان الامنيوتيك فلويد ولا الامبلايكال كورد ولا النيونيتال ثروت سوابس ولا البلاسينتال سوابس ولا الجينيتال فلويد ولا البريست ميلك سامبل انهم ترانسميتنج الانفكشن ودي حاجه مبشره اهو. دبليو اتش او طبعتها وقالت الابديت في الكورونا فيروس نو فيروس واز ديتكتد ان النيزوفارينجيال ولا السوابس بتاع البيبي ولا الامنيوتيك فلويد ولا الكورد بلاد ولا البريست ميلك ودي حاجة مبشرة جدا. وعلشان كده بيسمح للأمهات الديزيز إنهم بريست فيدينج مع الوير أوف فيش شيلد والبروتكشن ودي حاجة توصية الـ WHO أو لو كانت هي شكة قوي تعمل ميلك ليتنج بالسبيشال ساكشن ده وتدي الميلك بتاعها للفيتس. احنا قلنا في البداية خالص إن 2 ريسبتور بتاع السبايكس الريسبتورز دول فيهم واحد الـ ACE2 ده هو اللي بيشتغل عليه الجونادوتروفين في الأوفيريان اندكشن وهو الجونادوتروفين حتى في الفسيولوجي العادي الجاميتوجينيسيس بيبقى ثرو الريسبتورز دي. فعلشان كده في كويتشن مارك ان احنا ما نعملش البرامج اثناء وجود انفكشن لان بتبقى الريسبتور دي اكتيفيتد فبتسمح بمور فيرال انتري لو حصل الله لا يقدر انفكشن. زي ما بنقول الايزوليشن ذا بيست واي تو ستوب ذا كورونا فيروس او الكوفيد 19 از ايزوليشن على كل المستويات شمسيه اهي عزله كل الاستاف والكورونا فيروس اليرت وبي كورونا فيروس اليرت وستي سيف ات هوم وستي هوم تو هيلب تو سيف لايفز. ده كنصايح واضحة. وفي الأخير خالص الأمل العظيم للأمهات إنها توجيت أهيلسي بيبي وبرضو ما تنساش إنها تبقى كفولكلور تحط لها الكمامة أو الماسك وربنا ييسر ووفق ويقي البلاد والعباد شر الوباء وييسر الحال جميعا. وشكرا لحسن الاستماع.
متشكرين جدا الأستاذ الدكتور محمد سلامة على informative lecture. Time limitation, we'll try to have one or two questions لإيتش presenter. نبتدي أستاذ الدكتور جمال أبو سرور. السؤال الأولاني ميوما away from the cavity بتأفكت الإندوميتريوم مليو؟
دكتور بتحتاج ليه يا دكتور يا حبيبي؟
لو مايوما بعيد عن الكافيتي ممكن تأثر على الاندوميتريوم مليو by itself the mere presence of endometrium بيتأثر بوجود المايوما وحضرتك قلت في المحاضرة بس ياريت توضحه تاني.
Absolutely yes. If it is away from the endometrium this is not likely to affect the endometrial cavity the endometrium milieu. However, it does affect it, the fertility itself because of the production of oxytocin and oxytocin, which would result in peristalsis and increased uterine contractions, which would interfere with implantation and result in miscarriage as well.
أستاذ دكتور جمال برضو سؤال تاني، هل الميومكتومي by itself can affect the ovarian reserve?
The answer for this question is no. So long you are doing it in the right way and you are not causing massive devascularization of the uterus, no.
طيب سؤال تالت، هل الانترامورال فايبرويد في الناتشرال كونسبشن الافكت بتاعها مختلف عن الـ ART؟ I know it's very difficult to answer, of course.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, it's very difficult to answer, but I think, you know, most of the impact of fibroid on fertility and miscarriage came actually from IVF studies, because actually in natural conception, we cannot analyze this. But certainly one would expect that after successful implantation, and the occurrence of clinical pregnancy, then the impact would be the same.
Says Dr. Abubakar Nashar. Fee treatment of brucellosis during pregnancy?
Yes, for treatment of brucellosis in pregnancy, the safest is rifampicin. Rifampicin is anti-tuberculous drug. And it is, according to the FDA, it is category B, and it is not harmful at all. And but we should use it for at least of 6 weeks. The other alternative is not recommended, the trimethoprim and sulfamethoxazole. It is not recommended in the first trimester and in the third trimester, because in third trimester, it will be associated with hyperbilirubinemia. So the treatment is rifampicin.
السؤال الثاني it's very tricky question. DNA fragmentation في السبرم. السبيكترم واسع قوي من اول ما بيعملش حاجه لغايه بيعمل recurrent pregnancy loss. هل في اي مالتي سنتريك ترايل او في اي مالتي سنتريك ستاديز على الموضوع ده؟
For the recurrent pregnancy loss, there is a very good correlation between recurrent pregnancy loss and increased sperm DNA fragmentation. But there is no standardization of the test. And also there is no cut-off level about the sperm DNA fragmentation index. But most, if the sperm DNA fragmentation index is more than 30, it is associated with decrease the result of the IVF. The
بالنسبه للريكيرنت بريجننسي لوس ده السؤال،
يعني الريكيرنت بريجننسي لوس يس
ولو حصل هيحصل امتى؟ يعني very early on ولا later in pregnancy؟
يس it will occur early and it is recommended especially in unexplained recurrent pregnancy loss, because there is one study found that 80% of unexplained recurrent pregnancy loss is attributed to increased sperm DNA fragmentation.
السؤال الثاني، a role of hyperthyroidism for recurrent pregnancy loss.
Yes, it is has a role, and we should adjust the thyroid function before starting the IVF or ICSI.
السؤال الثالث برضو على الميتفورمين في الديابيتك وومن، هل ده ممكن يأثر على يقلل الريكرنت ميسكاريج ولا انا مش السؤال مش واضح، هل الكنترول ولا الميتفورمين ان بارتيكولر؟
Yeah, the metformin is one of the recommended doses and recommended drugs, anti-diabetic, and we should control the diabetes before preconceptional, before starting the pregnancy, because all the congenital fetal malformation occurs very early. And the as regards the recurrent pregnancy loss, the controlled diabetes is not a cause of recurrent pregnancy loss.
أستاذ دكتور أشرف ورطام، يا ترى what's your opinion about zinc administration and it can cause hypertension in some patients after 1 month of its intake?
بالنسبة للزنك intake, it depends why are you using the zinc or why are you supplementing it. Supplementation for a very long time, yes, has been claimed to have some sort of relation to hypertension, but not in the standard doses used. And we should differentiate between the doses which are used traditionally, varying from 8 to 11 milligrams per day, to those which are used in the COVID era, reaching between 30 to 40 or 30 to 50 per day. And these are used for a limited time and not for a very prolonged time. Hypertension is multifactorial, and the dependence here is not related just to zinc to make it occur. Levels of zinc should be very high to make the hypertension feasible to be related to the condition.
الأستاذ دكتور محمد سلامة, هل في effect لCOVID-19 on AMH? I don't believe في أي paper على حاجة زي كده.
لا والله ده سؤال جميل قوي. يعني هو من ضمن الحاجات وأنا بحضر المحاضرة إن من التريتمنت أوف لو في حالات البوف اللو أوفيريان ريزيرف, قالوا إن ده مش إميرجنسي على أساس لا تعالج ولا تدي أي حاجة, وعلشان كده يفهم إن ملوش إفكت. لو كان له إفكت قالوا هافتو يعني ناخد الفرصة سريعا. فما فيش أي إفكت الكوفيد 19 على الـ AMH level.
Not to our knowledge لغاية دلوقتي.
طبعا ده اللي أنا قريته. أنا مش معلومات.
دكتور أبو بكر معلش, يا ريت حضرتك تكلمنا تاني عن الـ app use of كليكسان في recurrent pregnancy loss.
كليكسان
يعني
yes. The only indication if we have antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, we should use the combination of cliclizumab and low dose aspirin. But as I mentioned, according to the guidelines, don't screen for thrombophilia. And if we have unexplained recurrent pregnancy loss, it was found that cliclizumab has no role in treatment of unexplained recurrent pregnancy loss.
طيب ده سؤال من عندي انا, لو عملوا ثرومبوفيليا لو العيانين هيتروزايجس, is this an indication for كليكسان?
If it is heterozygous, it is not an indication for كليكسان.
Thank you.
يبقى
العيانين اللي بياخدوا كليكسان في مصر 99% منهم ملوش اي قيمه الحقيقه. يعني استاذ دكتور جمال ابو السرور, سيرفايكال مايوما, would you remove it before IVF? لو سمحت عن ميوت يا دكتور جمال.
Yes, it depends upon its size and it depends upon whether it is affecting the introduction of the catheter by which you introduce your embryos. If it is small and not interfering with the passage of the cervical canal, I wouldn't remove it. But if it is large, then certainly it need to be removed. Yes, and distorting the cervical canal.
I think for the sixth time, it's 11 o'clock. We'd like to thank you all. We'd like to thank the lecturers and doctors, attendance almost 400 during the meeting. Inshallah, we can make another webinar with the subjects that are very interesting to all our colleagues. Thank you very much, everybody.
We thank our chairman too. Thank you. And we thank Devert Lab as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the society, the Egyptian society, for inviting us to be participate in this event. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Asher.
You are mostly welcome.
Thank you, Devert Lab. Good night, everybody.
Good night. Thank you. Good night.
كل سنة وانتم طيبين.